This is the fifth video in a series devoted to introductory proofwriting. And today we're going to look at quantifiers, both the universal quantifier for all, which has the symbol, which is like this upside down A, and the existential quantifier there exists, which has this symbol of a backwards E. So our main goal here for today will be to translate mathematical sentences into symbols using quantifiers, and also negate statements involving quantifiers. And that will kind of finish this topic of logic, or this very basic logic, and in the next video we'll start writing proofs using counting strategies. Okay, so let's look at these examples. So we'll translate each of these mathematical statements into symbolic notation. Okay, so the first one says, for every integer n, 2n is even. Okay, so we would write that as, for all n in z, 2n is even. That would be a way to do that. Another thing that we could do is maybe say, for all n in z, the e of 2n, where e of x is the statement or the open sentence, x is even. Okay, so let's look at this next one. Every subset of the numbers between 1 and 10 has 10 or fewer elements. Okay, so this says, for all x, which is a subset of the set containing 1 up to 10, the cardinality of x is less than or equal to 10. So that's how we would write that in symbolic notation. Now let's notice that this bit right here, x, a subset of the set containing 1 to 10, could be replaced with something involving the power set. We could say that this x is an element of the power set of this set containing 1 to 10. That's equivalent. Now let's look at this next one. There is a function whose derivative is itself. Okay, so we would say there exists an f such that f prime of x equals f of x. So there, we've got it. And of course, this is true. We can probably think of a function off the top of our heads. That would be the exponential function e to the x. Now let's look at this one. There is a subset of the natural numbers with exactly 330 elements. Okay, so we would say there exists an x, which is in the power set of the natural numbers. We could also say that it's a subset of the natural numbers like this. And then we'll have such that the cardinality of x equals 3030. Okay, so we're going to do quite a few examples here because I think it's helpful to see a lot of these. So let's get on it. So here are two more examples. So the first one says that every odd integer is one more than an even integer. So I think this is pretty clearly true, but the truth of the falsehood is not our goal here. Our goal is to rewrite it in symbols using quantifiers. So I think maybe something like this would work. For all n in z, where n is odd, there exists a k in z such that n equals 2k plus 1. So look, we've got an odd integer, and that says that this odd integer is one more than an even integer. Okay, so that's pretty good. Now let's look at this next one. If f is continuous on the closed interval a to b, f of a is negative and f of b is positive, then f of c equals 0 for some c between a and b. This is, of course, the intermediate value theorem, which you probably learned in a calculus class or maybe even a pre-calculus class. So this one's a little bit more complicated, but I think it's nice to dig into something like this. So we'll have f is continuous on the closed interval a, b. That'll be one statement. And f of a is less than 0. And f of b is bigger than 0. So that's what we have here. First of all, I maybe should have noted this first, that this is a conditional. Notice that we have if this stuff in orange brackets, then this stuff in blue brackets. So what I've done so far is I've exchanged all the stuff in orange brackets for a logically equivalent formulation using symbols. Okay, so since we have an if-then statement, this is gonna turn into a conditional or an implication. So all of the stuff in orange brackets will imply that there exists a C on the open interval A to B such that F of C equals zero. So that's where our quantifier lives here, this existential quantifier, which notice up here, the language was for some C between A and B. But that's equivalent to saying there exists a C between A and B such that F of C equals zero. Okay, so let's do some more. So here's our last example before moving on to some other stuff. For all integers n bigger than or equal to 3, the equation x to the n plus y to the n equals z to the n has no solution for x, y, z, which are natural numbers. So this is, of course, the statement of Fermat's last theorem, which we know to be true. Okay, so I think... Okay, so to rewrite this, we might do something like this. So if n is a natural number, and n is bigger than or equal to 3. So that would be this thing right here. For all integers n bigger than or equal to 3, that would be something like this. That implies that for all x, y, z in n, x to the n plus y to the n is not equal to z to the n. So this reads a little bit different than it does up here in the sentence form, but it has the same information. So sometimes when translating it from a sentence like this to symbolic notation, you might have to tweak it a little bit. Just based off the differences in natural English writing versus like natural logic writing. Okay, so now let's look at negating statements with quantifiers. So the rule for negating things with quantifiers is kind of similar to the rule for negating things with ands and ors. So remember, an and switches to an or, and an or switches to an and under negation. And in fact, for alls, or the universal quantifier, switches to a there exists, the existential quantifier, and vice versa under this negation. So properly, we have the negation of the statement for all x, p of x, is logically equivalent to the statement there exists x such that not p of x. And then similarly, the negation of the statement there exists x such that q of x is for all x, not q of x. Okay, so let's look at a couple of examples, starting with this one that says every even integer is of the form 2n, where n is an integer. So let's start by translating this into just another English statement that has the same information that will allow us to put it into symbols a little bit more easily. And that would be something like this. So for all n in z, 2n is even. Okay, good. So into symbols, we would have for all n in z, 2n is even. Okay, good. And now let's make our negation step. So let's say this magenta arrow means negate this. So I'll maybe put a negation here in blue. So that will negate to there exists an n in z such that 2n is not even. But of course, we've got a rule for not even, and that is odd. So 2n is odd. And now let's rewrite that into a sentence, and that sentence would be something like this. There is an integer n such that 2n is odd. Or maybe another way of writing this sentence would be 2n is odd for some integer n. Of course, these two equivalent statements, as well as this statement up here in symbols, are all false. But that's because we've negated a true statement. So the process here is not to investigate the truth or the falsehood. The process is to get some practice with negating statements. Our next thing to look at will be the negation of a conditional. So we're just gonna write it down real quick, and then we'll check that it works using a truth table, which I've already prepped. And then we'll look at some examples, which will make it even more evident. So the negation of the statement P implies Q is the statement P and not Q. So let's build out this truth table just to convince ourselves that this is the fact. So we've got P and Q set up. Let's now do our not Q. So that means we'll change every true to a false and every false to a true. So we've got false, true, false, true. And now let's do our P and not Q. Recall that both of those need to be true in order to get a truth out. That only occurs right here. So we've got a true here, but then we have falses everywhere else because at least one of those entries is false. But now let's compare that to P implies Q. And notice it's exactly the opposite of P implies Q. Here we have false true, true false true, and false true. But that means that it's logically equivalent to not P implies Q. So that establishes this logical equivalence over here. Now let's look at a little bit of an example of this, and then we'll do a bigger example. So if n is odd, then n cubed is even. So this seems like it should be a true statement. And in fact, it is a true statement. It's one of the very first types of proofs that we'll do. But let's negate this conditional. In order to do that really carefully, what I'd like to do is to put it in the form P implies Q. So we'll have n is odd implies n cubed is odd. Great. So this is playing the role of P, and this is playing the role of Q. And now let's make our negation. So this magenta arrow will be our negating operator. So we should have P and not Q. So we have n is odd and n cubed is even. Which notice I just went straight to putting an and here instead of the symbol, but I think it's okay in this case. Okay, so again, we started with a statement that seems to be true, and we ended with a statement that seems to be false, which is okay. Okay, now let's do a bigger example. Now let's look at this nice big example, which actually comes from a future math class that you probably haven't taken yet called real analysis, or sometimes advanced calculus. But what we have here is the precise definition of what it means for f to be differentiable at a. So what we have is this kind of complicated statement. For all epsilon bigger than zero, there is a delta bigger than zero such that if the absolute value of x minus a is between 0 and delta, then the absolute value of f of x minus f of a over x minus a minus some number L is less than epsilon. Okay, so our goal is to negate this, but our first step should be to translate it. So let's say this green arrow is the translation arrow. So we might have something like, for all epsilon bigger than zero, there is a delta bigger than zero. So that would be an existential. There exists a delta bigger than zero, such that if this happens, then this happens. So notice that's the conditional statement. So what we'll have is zero is less than x minus a minus delta implies the absolute value of f of x minus f of a over x minus a minus L is less than epsilon. So we've got something like that. So probably the first thing to notice is if we have these quantifier setups, and after those quantifier setups, we have a conditional statement. I'll say this is P implies Q. So P is this inequality and Q is this inequality. So that means to do our negation, we'll need to exchange for alls for there exists and vice versa in this quantifier setup. And then we'll need to negate our conditional using the rule that we have over here. Okay, so let's do it. So we'll have something like this. There exists epsilon bigger than zero such that for all delta bigger than zero, we have P and not Q. So that would be zero is less than x minus a, which is less than delta, and the absolute value of f of x minus f of a over x minus a minus l is bigger than or equal to epsilon. So notice the negation of a less than is a greater than or equal to. Okay, now we might want to put this back into words. So that would go something like this. There exists epsilon bigger than zero, such that for all delta bigger than zero, zero is less than the absolute value of x minus a, which is less than delta, and the absolute value of f of x minus f of a over x minus a minus l is bigger than or equal to epsilon. So if this up here, what we started with, is the precise definition of f being differentiable at a, this down here would be the precise definition of f being non-differentiable at a. So f is not differentiable at a. So of course, some functions are differentiable and some functions are not differentiable. So in order to show that a function is not differentiable, you would show that it satisfies this definition right here. So we're going to finish this video off with some rules of logical inference, and then after that I'll give you some warm-ups. Now we're going to look at some rules of logical inference. So we'll start with inferring things from the truth of the conditional P implies Q. This first inference is called modus ponens. And that says if we know P is true, then Q is true. Then the second one is called modus tollens. And that says if we know Q is false, then P is false. So let's look at a quick example of that. So here we've got our conditional. If a function f is differentiable, then it is continuous. So again, this is a well-known result from differentiable calculus that we've used several times in the past. Now, let's maybe apply these two rules. So we know the function f of x equals e to the x plus x sine x is differentiable. So it is continuous. So it must be continuous. So let's say, for instance, that it's easier to test if that function is differentiable, then we get that it's continuous for free based off this larger result. Okay, so now let's look at another one. So we know the function g of x equals the floor of x. So let's recall the floor of x is like an elevator down to the closest integer. So the floor of a half is zero. The floor of 3/4 is also zero. But the floor of 1 is 1 because you don't have to go down at all. Okay, so back to this. We know that g of x equals the floor of x is not continuous. So it must be non-differentiable. So not differentiable. Great. Now it might be kind of tricky to straightforwardly show that this is not a differentiable function, but it's easy to show that it's not a continuous function. Now let's look at one more logical inference, and this is called elimination. And here we suppose that the OR statement, P or Q, is true. And then we know that if P is false, then Q has to be true. Okay, so let's look at an example of that. So every even integer is even or odd. So I think that's pretty clear. Now let's note that 3 is not even. So it's not even, it's not a multiple of 2. So it must be odd. Must be odd. And then this may seem kind of silly, but this either or kind of thing actually shows up quite a bit in our proof techniques moving forward. So now I'll leave you with some warm-up exercises. So here are three nice warm-up exercises that are based off what we just saw. So for each of them, we'd like to translate them into symbolic logic, use that translation to easily negate these statements, and then write the negation back into a sentence. So that's a nice kind of holistic practice of everything that we saw. Okay, this first one says, for every capital M bigger than zero, there is a delta bigger than zero such that if the absolute value of X minus A is less than delta, then, I missed my then, let's get that in there, then F of X is bigger than M. I'd like to point out real quick, just as a point of interest, this is the precise definition of the limit as X goes to A of F of X equals infinity. So that's pretty cool. The next one says, there is a real number A such that A times X equals X for all X in R. So of course we know exactly what that real number is. It is the real number one. That being said, you know, that's not what we're going for here. We'd like to do all of this stuff. Next, we have the statement, for every X in R, N is bigger than X for some natural number N. This is actually technically called the Archimedean principle. And that's a good place to stop.